In a previous video, I introduced the definition of the derivative as well as an example on how to use the definition of the derivative to help you solve a question. However, I only used a quadratic function. In this video, I will show you how to use the definition of the derivative to help solve questions that are not limited to quadratic functions. I'll go over all the different type of functions you're likely to see that would ask you to use the definition of the derivative to find the slope. Let's go. Before we start, just a quick note that every single question we do in this video will be asking for the equation of a tangent line. That's because it requires the most steps that you need to use when it comes to solving questions for the definition of the derivative. However, it doesn't mean that every question you see on the test will ask you to find the equation of the tangent line. Sometimes they might only ask you to find the derivative or the slope, so keep that in mind and don't make it into a habit. All right, the first example we're going to do is for a quadratic function, and we're going to follow the procedure of first finding the derivative and then finding the slope, finding the point, and then with the point and the slope, we can now find the equation of the tangent line in point-slope form. Starting with the definition of the derivative, we have to focus on the numerator. The f of x is easy because it's always given to us, so we can substitute this expression into the f of x. For the f of x plus h, we substitute x plus h into where x is in the original function, and then we can expand and simplify to give us something that looks like this, and that we can plug in where f of x plus h is, giving our definition of derivative this look like this. Keep in mind the brackets on the right-hand side are super important because we have to distribute its subtraction sign into the brackets, making it look like this. Now we can simplify it and combine like terms, and now we have something that looks like this. This is good because every single term on the numerator has an h, which means we can factor it out, and once we factor it out, we can cross it out with a denominator, which solves the main problem because we cannot plug in 0 for h when there is an h in the denominator. Now the limit only has the numerator looking like this, and once we only have the numerator, we can now feel free to plug in 0 for h, which gives us something that looks like this. Notice the limit is gone now once we substitute 0 in for h, and a quick simplification gives us something that looks like this. This is our derivative. However, we can't stop here because we have to find the slope. Let's look back at the question here. They're asking for the equation of the tangent line where x is equal to 1. So to find the slope, we have to plug in x as 1 into the derivative. So our derivative would have a 1, and you'll see that the f prime of 1 is equal to 11, and that is our slope. Once we have the slope, our next goal is to find a point, or the y-coordinate. In this case, we always use the original function. We already know that the x-coordinate is 1, so we plug it into the original function, giving us a y-coordinate of negative 1, which means the point has coordinates 1, negative 1. With the slope and the coordinates, now we can plug them into the point-slope form, giving us the point-slope form of y plus 1 equals 11, brackets x minus 1. If you leave your answer as a point-slope form, that will be your answer. Or if they ask for the slope-intercept form, you can isolate y and get that as well. All right, next question is for a cubic function. Exact same thought process. We're going to have to find the slope, the point, and then plug them into the point-slope form. Starting with the definition of the derivative, on the numerator, the f of x, again, is always given to us. To find the f of x plus h, substitute the x plus h into where the x is in the original function, expand and simplify, and we get something long and big just like this. We can then substitute this into where f of x plus h is, making our limit look like this. Again, don't forget to FOIL the negative sign into the brackets, getting rid of the brackets. Now we can combine like terms and cross things out as we please, leaving us with something that looks like this. Again, this is good because every single term in the numerator has an h, which means we can factor it out, giving us something that looks like this. Once we factor it out, we can cross out the denominator, getting rid of the fraction. Now we only have the numerator left. Once we only have the numerator left, we can now plug in 0 for h, which gets rid of the limit, and we can simplify this, and this here is our derivative. To find the slope, we have to look at the question again and see that our x equals 3, which means we plug in 3 for x in a derivative, giving us a slope value of 9. Once we have the slope, it's time to find the point. We know that the x-coordinate is 3, so we look at the original function and plug in 3 for x into the original function, giving us a y-value of negative 5, which means the coordinates of this point is 3, negative 5. Now we can plug both of these things into the point-slope form, giving us something that looks like this. You can leave your final answer either in the point-slope form, or you can leave it as the slope-intercept form. Next, we have a rational function where we have an x in the denominator and a numerator here. In a rational function, just like other functions, our thought process is exactly the same. Find the derivative, then the slope, then the point, and then plug them into the point-slope form. Now, taking a look at the definition of the derivative here, focusing on the numerator, our f of x, again, is given to us for free. However, to find the f of x plus h, we have to substitute the x plus h into where x is, and then we can simplify it to make it look like this. Now we can plug both of these into the limit, which makes it look like this. And at this point, it looks a little bit convoluted. We have a fraction subtracting a fraction on the numerator of a bigger fraction that has h in the denominator. Let's only focus on the numerator here. When we have two fractions subtracting each other, we need to find the lowest common denominator. In this case, it'll just be the two denominators side by side, which is x plus h plus 1 and x plus 1, which means we'll multiply both fractions by the missing part of the lowest common denominator. In that way, we can combine into one fraction. And at this point, we can simplify both the top and the bottom of the fraction, leaving us with something that looks like this. Now, we can simplify the numerator by crossing out like terms, giving us something that looks like this. Okay, at this point, let's take a look. If we have a fraction all over h, that's the same thing as writing something like 1 over 2 divided by h, which is another way of writing 1 over 2 times 1 over h, which becomes 1 over 2h. So what happened here? The h pretty much went onto the denominator of the fraction on the top. And that is what we can do here. So in this case, the h can be multiplied to the denominator on the top, making it look like this. And this is good because now we can cross out the h on the numerator with the h on the denominator, leaving us with something that looks like this. And at this point, we can now confidently plug in h as 0, which gets rid of the limit for us, and simplify that a little bit, giving us something that looks like this. And that is going to be our derivative, which is great. However, we need to find the slope still. So back to the question we go, they're asking for x equals 1. So we're going to plug in 1 into the derivative, giving us the slope of 1. Once we have the slope, same thing as always, we have to find the point, which means we look at the original function, plugging in 1 for x, giving us a y value of 2. That means our point is 1, 2. We can plug them into the point slope form, giving us this. Our final answer would be this for point slope form or this for slope intercept form. The last function we're going to look at is the radical function. Again, exact same thought process here, finding the slope and then the point. You get the idea here. Looking at the definition of the derivative, we already know that f of x was given to us in the question. F of x plus h can just be found by substituting x plus h into where x is in the original question. You can leave it like this, that's okay, or you can simplify it. In this case, I will just simplify it. Now we can substitute both of these into the original limit, making it look like this. All right, now what? Ordinary algebra isn't going to save us here because we can't really do anything when we have a radical subtracting a different radical. There's only one thing we can do here, and it revolves around the term conjugate. Let's take a look at this. This will be known as a difference of squares. We can factor it, and it turns into something that looks like that. These two brackets are known as conjugates. Let's take a look. Conjugates would have identical terms, but opposite signs. Okay, what if I have x plus 2, and I want to turn it back into x squared minus 4? Well, I would have to multiply it by its conjugate. And we can prove it here. When we multiply these two brackets, we would have to FOIL, and we'll end up with something that looks like this. The middle terms will cancel out, giving us an answer of x squared minus 4, which is what we expected. Let's take a look at a different example here. X squared minus 2. Well, this here isn't technically a difference of squares because we can't square root the 2, although we can still write it like this. We can just write root 2. Notice one has a plus sign and one has a minus sign. Okay, how do we turn x plus root 2 into x squared minus 2? What I would have to multiply by the conjugate. Why would we want to do this? Because it's a lot harder to deal with roots than it is with just regular numbers. So let's show again how we can turn this into the x squared minus 2. We would have to FOIL and end up with something that looks like this. Notice the minus 2 at the end. When we have root a times root a, the answer is just going to be a, which means if you have root 2 times root 2, the answer would just be 2. The middle terms cross out again. And at this point, we're thinking, if the middle terms always cross out, then why bother multiplying the insides when we FOIL? And we don't need to when we multiply conjugates. So we only have to multiply the first term with the first term and the second term with the second term, giving us an answer of x squared minus 2. All right, back to where we were. So at this point, it's clear that we have to multiply the top by the conjugate. Notice the plus sign instead of the minus sign in our conjugate. But that's not very fair. In math, what we do to the top, we have to do to the bottom as well. Okay, how do we multiply the top? We just have to multiply the first term with the first term and the second term with the second term, giving us something that looks like this. Notice I put brackets around both the product of the first terms and the product of the second terms. The first brackets aren't that important, but the second pair of brackets are important because of the minus sign. So we're going to distribute the negative sign into the brackets, giving us something that looks like this. At this point, we can simplify the numerator, which will end up with something that looks like this. And at this point, we can now cross out the h on the top with the h on the bottom. That eliminates the h, which is awesome, so that we have this. And now we can plug in 0 for h when we see an h, getting rid of the limits, simplify the bottom. And now we can simplify it even more because the two radicals on the bottom are identical. So that becomes 2 over 2 root 2x minus 7. The 2s cancel out, giving us 1 over 2, giving us 1 over root 2x minus 7. And that is our derivative. To find the slope, we have to look at the x value, which is 4. So we can plug in now 4 into our derivative, giving us 1 as the slope. To find the point, we have to plug in 4 into the original function, giving us a y-coordinate of 1, which means the point has coordinates 4, 1, which we can now plug into the point-slope form, giving us something that looks like this. Final answer for this question would be this in the point-slope form, or this in the slope-intercept form.
And those are all the examples for this video. Hope you like it. See you in the next video. Bye!
If you like this video, consider subscribing to my YouTube channel, and also follow me on my other social media platforms.